It's nice to be to come back to a continent with a rising financial system, and of course Kenya illustrates this probably more than any other country in this continent, at least among the countries that I know. There might be others. I remember, and I'm of course compared to many others in this audience, I'm a relative newcomer to Kenya. My first trip here was 10 years ago. And I remember 10 years ago, there was a very different banking and financial system than we have it today. Very different players, a very different level of financial inclusion, of products available, and lots of things have happened in these past 10 years, and I'm going to come back to this in just a moment. But let me say that the picture I'm showing you here is, shows that this general upward trend in financial deepening, and here of course I'm using a very crude proxy measure, which is private credit or GDP, is not just limited to certain countries, but it's actually very broad based. So if you look at this trend over the past 15 years, at different levels, here I show you the 25th, the 50th, and the 75th percentile, you can see this is a broad-based trend across African countries in terms of financial deepening. And of course, this also goes hand in hand with a much more stable financial system. After a bout of systemic banking crisis in the 80s and the 90s, financial systems in general, not everywhere, but in general, have become much more stable, which of course also allows the financial deepening that I showed you on the previous slide. Now, behind these very aggregate measures, there are lots of things happening on the ground in terms of financial innovation. And again, I'm very grateful for being in a region where financial innovation doesn't come with certain three-letter words such as CDO, CDS, or SPV. But lots of financial innovation, such as new players in the system that also bring more competition, bring additional financing sources. Microfinance, of course, here in Kenya, for example, Equity Bank, or similar players in other countries of the region. New players coming from outside the financial system, such as telecom companies, but also providers of additional financing sources, such as equity funds, which I think we should focus maybe more on. New products, of course, come with new institutions, leasing, factoring, but even agricultural lending is picking up. And also, even more importantly, new delivery channels, new lending techniques, such as, thank you. Such as new ways to reach out to the bottom of the pyramid and to previously unbanked shares of the population. So lots of things going on, lots of challenges as well still remaining, and I noted with interest yesterday that His Excellency Mr. Ruto pointed among the two challenges that he mentioned, one of them was in the area of finance, and I'm not going to talk much about more about this because I think we're going to come back to this this afternoon in the panel session. So still lots of challenges, but I think overall certainly a very positive picture. And I have to say that part of this positive picture has to do also with cross-border banking. I'm not going to try to paint a very rosy picture, because as I'm going to point out later, there are certain risks involved with cross-border banking, with financial globalization. And again, I'm coming from a region where this is very acute. The dynamic nature of the financial system is also associated with cross-border banking, not so much actually with this picture, which just shows you that the share of cross-border banking has been traditionally very high in Africa, although of course we know there's a lot of cross-country variation ranging from basically zero in countries such as Ethiopia, Eritrea, to countries where the banking system is almost completely dominated by foreign banks such as, for example, Madagascar and Mozambique. But maybe the dynamic nature is not really illustrated here, but it's illustrated in this picture, which shows you the share of foreign banks. This is the upper line, but then also the share of non-European or non-developed country foreign banks In the lower line, this is the median country. The median country. That's why it jumps around a little bit. But it shows you that the importance of non-European banks, non-European foreign banks, has increased quite a lot over the past 15 years in these regions. And of course, again, we can also see this. We can also put specific names to that. We've seen, of course, the South African banks going north. We've seen the Nigerian banks going east. We've seen specific banks, Ecobank, Bank of Africa, spreading out throughout the continent. And more recently, in this sub-region here in East Africa, for example, seeing Kenyan banks going to Uganda, Tanzania, and Rwanda, for example. So there's lots of things happening. And what I'm going to argue is that with this come a lot of benefit, but also new challenges for the regulatory framework for regulators and supervisors. That's going to be kind of my bottom line. Lots of benefits, lots of opportunities, but also new risks and new challenges for regulators and supervisors that have to be taken on.